Hi and welcome. In the next few minutes, you will learn how to set toggles up, how to get values from them through script, how to assign methods to them with code, how to work with toggle groups, and how to add a bit of life and style to them. You will find the default toggle in UI toggle when creating a new object. It comes with a few elements: the main toggle component, which handles interactions, the background of the box, the graphics for the checkmark, and, for whatever reason, a plain text component. This is not Text Mesh Pro, but you can safely get rid of this and add a new text label to your object, and I highly recommend you do so. I mean, in case you need a text label to begin with. Check my playlist on Text Mesh Pro if you'd like to learn more. Back to the toggle component. You probably already know these settings from a typical button component. They handle how your toggle will behave when being interacted with, and we will come back to these in a moment when we get to styling our toggles. Functionality-wise, these settings down here are the important ones. IsOn handles if the toggle is currently set to checked or not. Toggle transition is again for styling, so we will come back to that in a moment. And graphic refers to the background of your checkbox. Because toggles typically live in Hertz, you can also assign a toggle group, which we will check out once we are done with the basics. And this box is handling what's going to happen if your toggle gets, well, toggled. So let's write some code. I'm creating a toggle functionality script for this tutorial. Let's start with writing a method we can call from our toggle component. To do so, your method needs to get handed a bool parameter. To see what's going to happen, I added a simple Text Mesh Pro text box to the scene and hooked it up in our script like this. Back in the inspector, we attach it to the toggle by attaching it somewhere. I'll use the toggle itself, and adding a new entry to the onValueChanged box like this. If you correctly set up the method with a bool parameter, your method will show up at the top of the list. It will always get the value the toggle is currently set to, so let's give it a try. Well, this looks promising. But if we want this to work the other way around and we want to set the toggle through script, let's add the toggle at the top and a method that toggles the toggle's isOn value like this. You can, of course, just set it to true or false if needed as well. In the scene, we need something to trigger this method, so I set up a button for this. I drag the test script into this box, start the game, and yes, this works. As you can see, the method we assigned to the toggle value is correctly being called as well. Setting up script dependencies like this in the inspector is useful, but sometimes we need to dynamically assign what is supposed to happen if a toggle value gets changed. In those cases, we need to add so-called listeners to onValueChanged through script. OnValueChanged is a Unity event that is called whenever the value changes. In onEnable, we can add a method to this event by adding this line of code. It has the added benefit that methods attached like this can stay private, while the ones you attach through the inspector need to be public. Thus, I will make our initial method private now. Whenever you are working with events, it is good practice to unsubscribe everything when it's no longer needed. I typically use onDisable for this. Each of these methods is being called when the object that added the listeners is either disabled or destroyed. If you don't remove listeners, your code might run into problems. And on the topic of subscribing, if you have enjoyed this tutorial thus far, please give it a like to let me know if I should create more similar content, and consider subscribing to receive more tutorials like this one. In the inspector, our method has correctly been removed from the list of methods to call onValueChanged, as it's now private and can't be accessed from outside anymore. If we run the game and interact with the toggle, we can see it working. Now, lots of toggles are in fact herd animals and live in close-knit groups. If one gets toggled on, others need to get toggled off. You can get this behavior by creating a new parent game object and adding the toggle group component. Sort all toggles that should be part of that group under it as child elements. Select all and drag the toggle group into this field. we can now only allow for a single element to be toggled on, and in case we need the group to allow for all things to be toggled off, do that as well. With functionality done, let's tackle the design part. First, we can tell the toggle if we want the checkmark graphic to fade in and out or instead just appear and disappear through this dropdown. The second option makes it feel a bit more snappy, while the first one will give you a little bit more time for animations and other effects. You already know how color tints work, I suppose. Just pick some color you want to show up on hover, click, and so on. Adding a little bit of this to an otherwise default checkbox can already go a long way. Sprite switching can give cool little effects as well. Set up some graphics for each state, and your toggles will look much more thematic and interaction aware. I won't go over the animation options, as that would really use its own tutorial. Instead, let's add two simple effects to the toggle. First, a little squash and stretch effect. You will learn how to create this effect in this video. So here I'll just add the component to the toggle and link it up in the toggle functionality script like this. Add a reference at the top and play squash and stretch when the value changes. From here, this effect gets fine-tuned in the inspector. We want it to affect X and Y axes, don't want to reset the scale after playing, change the animation curve and give it a try. Exactly how you want your effect to look like depends a lot on the style of your game. And now, our checkmark graphic will display a little squash and stretch animation, adding to polish and feel. For the particles, I am using a very good asset, but it's a paid one. It's called UI Particle Image, and by now I install it by default into every project. It makes adding particles to UI a breeze, and this is not sponsored in any way. I add a new child element below the checkmark box and add the particle UI image to it. I'll just keep the values I changed and set on the screen for a moment. It is a very mighty tool. Why am I not using the default Unity one? That system doesn't work if the UI is set to screen space overlay mode, and I typically like my UI to stay that way. Also, on a higher resolution, the entries for the default system are barely readable, while UI Particles Inspector is clean, well-structured, and very readable. You will find a link to this in the video's description. Back in the toggle script, I reference the particle image and call it if the value of your toggle is set to true. I hope you enjoyed this tutorial. Let me know if you have questions either here or over on my Discord. Have a great week!